Just a little talk with Jesus makes it all right. We are blessed to be in the house of God once again. It is only by God's grace and only by His mercy that we are here to give another worship that we can to God, and we are thankful that He allowed us to be here one more time to worship Him in spirit and in truth. And we thank you for being here on tonight. I don't know if there was a Rocket celebration. I don't know if they won or they didn't win. I don't know. They played at 1:30 today. I don't know if they won or not. But nevertheless, we are glad to be in the house of God once again to worship and to give our attention to God as we get ready for things in the upcoming week. We want to have our minds right as we worship God, and then so we can be better people for God. Here to worship God in spirit and in truth. Amen. I want to thank Brother Tucker once again, and we ask for your prayers for traveling grace for he and of course others as well as they travel, and pray for those who will be driving back from Bryan on today. We appreciate the elders as well for this opportunity. I want to go to the book of Philippians chapter 2, Philippians chapter 2, beginning at verse number 1, Philippians chapter 2, beginning at verse number 1. The Apostle Paul is writing to the saints in Christ Jesus, which are at Philippi, and he says, according to the King James Version, if there be therefore any consolation in Christ, if any comfort of love, if any fellowship of the Spirit, if any bowels and mercies, fulfill ye my joy, that you be like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord, of one mind. Let nothing be done through strife or vain glory, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem other better than themselves. Look not every man on his own things, but every man also on the things of others. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, and took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Once again, as we look at the thought on the gateway to greatness, in the book of Philippians, we see one of the great Christological passages of the Bible, where it looks at the doctrine or the deity of Christ. And the deity of Christ, the supremacy, the preeminence of Christ is so pivotal to the life of the child of God. When we understand who Christ is, that Christ is not just another man, that Christ is just not some made of being, but he was actually God in the flesh. Amen. That he was God and man, that he was fully God and fully man. There's some who they really can't wrap their minds around that concept, but that's what the Bible teaches, that he was fully God and fully man. Amen. And that if we want to find out how to be united, how to have joy, how to be peaceful, how to be sacrificial, it is because of Jesus and through Christ and him being our example, we can live victoriously, we can live in a great way that pleases God, and it will benefit our lives when we know who Jesus is. When Paul returned to Philippi, he hoped to find a church that was united in Christ. In the book of Philippians, chapter 1, verse 27, and chapter 4, verse 9, is a multifaceted call for unity in the church. In chapter 1, Paul talks about his experience, about how he's put in chains and in prison, but how his bonds have now further advanced the gospel. And Paul would say it's not just about him, but it's about the gospel being preached. So even if someone preached the gospel for the wrong reason or preached it out of vain or for the wrong purpose, as long as Christ is preached, God is glorified. Amen. And he talked about being, Paul would say in Philippians chapter 1, there was a change in metaphor. He talked about from a soldier being on defense to almost like a football player being on offense. And he was saying, Philippians 1:27, that your conversation should be as one that whether I come or see you, that you would stand fast in one spirit, with one mind, striving together for the faith of the gospel. And in this Christological passage, in Philippians chapter 2, just as in John chapter 1 and Colossians chapter 1, we see the greatness, we see the excellence of Christ. But Paul would help us to see that the believers in Philippi had gotten to the point where maybe they got a little selfish. And Paul was trying to help them to see there were two sisters in the church, Euodia and Syntyche. And Euodia and Syntyche were two hard-working sisters, but they now have gotten in arms with them. So Paul is trying to get them to come back to being in Christ and not on the different accord, but being on one accord. But if we're going to be on one accord, if we're going to have less backbiting, less gossiping, less disunity, it's going to be because we follow Christ's example. That's the only way. If we have Christ's example, you'll have better homes. If we have Christ's example, we'll have better schools. If we have Christ's example, we'll have better communities when we follow the example of Jesus. And so when Paul was saying that you be like-minded and that you have the same, notice what he says here in Philippians chapter 2. He says that, fulfill my joy, that you be like-minded, having the same love. This is rooted in the fact that God wants us all to care about one another.
Man.
And when we put other people first, it used to be a time where people would hold open the door for people. It used to be a time where people would sit down when somebody, a lady is standing, and they would give up their seat. But now it's a time where people say, no, do those things. They'll beat an older lady to a seat, and they won't even get up. But Paul is saying, be humble. See, service is who Jesus was. Jesus came not to receive and not to have his name be exalted. He came to serve others. And that's when we come to serve other people, there'll be less, notice what he says, let nothing be done through strife or vainglory. Now maybe I'm talking to the wrong crowd tonight, but there's a lot of strife in the church. There's a lot of people who want to be, Brother Fleming, they want to get the lights. They want to be in the lights. They want to be, I want my name, I want to be where you hear me preach, if you hear me sing, and don't have me do anything else unless my name is called, unless I'm in the front. And then sometimes leaders get to the point where we do things and we bicker and we fight. He said, don't have anything to be done with strife or vainglory. See, the confidence in Christ and the common Christian experience and purpose, it rules out self-centered attitudes, self-serving attitudes. Those who follow Christ follow him in selfless service to others. When we obey the gospel and we become part of the local church or a local congregation, we've signed up for service.
Amen.
You know, it used to be a song, Sign Me Up. We used to sing that, sign me up for a Christian Jubilee, write my name. And we don't sing on the roll, I can change. I want to be ready when Jesus comes, but you have to serve. You're not going to be ready by not serving. See, Jesus wants us to serve, and so he says, don't have anything to be done through strife or vain glory, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem other better than themselves. It's like what Paul said in Romans chapter 12 and verse number 10. In Romans chapter 12, when Paul would talk about these spiritual gifts, not in a miraculous sense, but he's talking about these gifts that the Christians had there. In verse number 9, he says, in Romans 12, let love be without dissimulation. Abhor that which is evil. Cleave to that which is good. Then he would go on to say, be kindly affectionate one to another with brotherly love, in honor, preferring one another. He would go on to talk about not being slothful and serving the Lord and distributing to the necessity of the saints and all of those kind of things. Bless those who bless, don't persecute others, and bless those, and rejoice with those who rejoice, and weep with those who weep. When we have the attitude of humility, we're not looking about how much prestige I get. It's about Christ being exalted. And it's about serving one another. See, when I serve somebody else, then I'm glorifying God. But as long as I'm getting all of the accolades and all of the honor and all of the prestige, then Christ may not be glorified. If it's all about weapons, then it's not about Christ. And see, I'm just going to use me for a second because I'm going to use me. Sometimes even with me, I got some selfish ways. And sometimes even with me, sometimes I don't like to share. And I don't want to give up what I think is mine. But when it comes to following Christ, and when it comes to serving others, and when it comes to being a Christian, we've got to get out of just me.
Yeah.
And we've got to help and share with somebody else. But really it's rooted in having the mind of Christ. It's maturity. It's humility. If we have the mind of Christ, we're going to be involved in ministry. You know, today even I went to a service where a preacher was it was a luncheon for a preacher who was being made the assistant minister of a congregation in the Lord's church. And I saw where they had all of the sisters, and they were standing, and they were all serving, and they were standing all behind, and they were giving out food and turkey necks and all this, and a lot of stuff. And it was, but you saw this assembly line of sisters serving. It wasn't seeming like any fussing. It wasn't, they were just glad to serve. See, sometimes we get into the body where we don't have the mind of Christ. People can be involved in ministry, but if they don't have the right spirit, they can turn people away. You can end up with people at odds and people and other things that happen when they don't have the right spirit. But we have the mind of Christ. Paul was saying in Philippians, it's a kenosis passage. Really, it's based upon the idea of the word that he emptied himself. It would say that Christ, he put himself on the cross. He was God, but yet he came down. He was God, but yet he made himself man. He was God, but he lowered himself.
Oh, Lord.
That's how much humanity and power under control he had. He was a man among men, but he had power under control. So he went to the cross for our sins. He went to the cross for us who didn't deserve it, and he gives us a picture of what it means to be a servant. That's what gives us that idea about being a sister. When you become a part of the body of Christ, you sign up for service. You sign up for being a part of a ministry. You sign up for being a part of a class or a work. You don't just sign up for, I just come here and check off a box. But God wants us to be involved in serving. And if we have the mind of Christ, see, the mind of Christ is about the kingdom of God. It's about, not about my recognition. It's not about whether people spoke to me or whether they said something. It's not even about if they didn't like the song. But it's about the glory of God. Amen. And if we have that kind of mentality that we're about helping somebody else and being, and when we understand about this is that Christ suffered, Christ went through pain and agony. Sometimes we might go through that. Sometimes other Christians don't work and support and serve, and sometimes you may feel overwhelmed, and I've got to do this, and I've got to do that. And sometimes, you know, I was telling Brother Lewis, that sometimes you've got to do more than maybe what you want to do.
Man.
You've got to be on, you got to do this, you got to do this, you got to be like, what other brothers, what other people, why are they not doing nothing but? But we still serve. Sometimes you may be tired from working and tired from doing this and tired from doing that, but as long as God is glorified, then it's a great moment. See, Jesus helps us to see what it is to be humble, to be meek, and to be lowly. It's going to help us in our jobs, in marriages. It's going to help us in our day-to-day activities. It's going to help us when we realize who Christ was and what he did, and that we're about being in the Lord's arms. And if, as long as we do that, God will be pleased with us, and we'll glorify his name. And if there may be somebody here tonight, maybe you haven't signed up for the Lord's arms. Maybe you're not in Christ. You can be in Christ tonight. You can be a child of God tonight. This is a wonderful day. It's the fifth Sunday. This is a great day to give your life to. You've heard the gospel this evening. Christ died for our sins. He was buried in a barn tomb. And he rose with all power in his hands. If you're willing to believe that same thing, if you're willing to repent of your sins, if you're willing to confess him to be the Son of God and be baptized in water, and I want to, Brother Lewis, give Romans 6 for a second, because I didn't read Philippians 2, 5 through 11. But Paul said in Philippians 2:11, he talked about after Christ went to that cross, he said that every knee is going to bow.
Yeah.
And every tongue is going to confess that Jesus Christ is Lord because of what he did. God has given him a name that's above every name. That the name of Jesus, every knee is going to bow. But you're going to have to, just as Christ did, we have to symbolically, if we want to be saved, do the same thing he did. Romans chapter 6, verse 1, verse 5.
What shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin, that grace may abound? God forbid. How shall we, that are dead to sin, live any longer therein?
All right.
Know ye not that so many of us, as were baptized into Jesus Christ, were baptized into his death? Therefore we are buried with him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life.
Notice that the Bible says that if we're in Christ, we can't say where the grace of God covers me when I sin. That the more I sin, the more God's grace. He said, what shall we And he said that those who were baptized into Christ, just as Christ was, just as Christ died and was buried and was resurrected, so also we must die to sin, and we must be buried in the tomb of baptism so we can rise and walk in newness of life. And if you haven't done that, into Christ, if you have not done that, then you cannot be a child of God if you haven't done what God has said for you. So if you need to do that on tonight, you can do that tonight. You can be a Christian. You can be a child of God. And once you become a Christian, you become an heir of God. You become a joint heir with Christ. That is better. I may not be saying something to the people that are here tonight, but even if somebody sees me, when you become a Christian, you're better. You have more privileges than Buffett, than Mayweather, than Gates. You become an heir of God.
Amen.
You've got all spiritual blessings. You've got the hope of heaven. You've got something to look forward to. You can have bad things happen in life, on your job, in your family. You can lose a loved one. You can have adversity. But when you're in Christ, you're an heir of God.
Amen.
You got something that nobody else has. You know, I don't know anybody that really, I don't know if any inheritance I have. I don't know anybody probably that's got any money that's got my name on it. But I'm an heir of God. I'm a joint heir with Christ. I'm rich in Jesus Christ. I'm not rich materially, but I'm rich in Christ. I'm rich because I'm a Christian. If you're not a Christian on tonight, I'd urge you to give your life to Jesus. If you haven't, you say, I don't know where to serve. I haven't been involved in any ministry. There are plenty of ministries here in South Philly. There's somewhere for you to serve. There's plenty of places here, somewhere for you to be involved in. There's some, maybe you don't know where you fit in or where you can be. But when you become a Christian, you sign up for service.
Amen.
And so maybe you need prayer tonight. Maybe you want to strengthen your resolve. You want to be more dedicated to the cause of Christ. You've been a good audience on tonight, but maybe you want to be more dedicated. Maybe you need prayer. The Bible in James chapter 5 talks about the prayers of the righteous are powerful and they're effective. And Peter says in 1 Peter 3 that the eyes of the Lord are over the righteous and his ears are open unto their prayers, but the face of the Lord is against them that do evil. Prayer changes things.
Yeah.
Prayer is powerful. Prayer does some wonderful things when we talk to God. Maybe you need prayer. If you need prayer, you can ask for prayer. One of the elders will pray for you. Or if you need to repent of sin, you can do that tonight as well, because we don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. We don't know what tomorrow holds, but we know who holds tomorrow. So maybe you need prayer. Maybe you need to repent of sin. Maybe you need to be baptized into Christ. We'd urge you to do that right now as we stand and sing the song of invitation.
I would linger the wandering cross.